Breathless is Jean-Luc Godard's first feature film. He had made a few short films prior to this. It stars Belmondo, who became a very important actor in France after this, Seberg, who started a new phase in her career at this point. And also having this being the beginning of Jean-Luc Godard's relationship with cinematographer Raoul Cotard, a close cinematographer for him for many years after this, who tried to sort of, Cotard and both Godard had tried to capture characters in their environments who are then interacting with their environments by use of cinematographic techniques such as deep focus and in line with sort of André Bazin's approach to filmmaking. The script, the first treatment for the script was written by François Truffaut, who was another French New Wave director, an accomplice of Godard in that. And Truffaut, a year previous, had released the critically acclaimed 400 Blows, one of the first French New Wave films to gain international attention. Godard's filmmaking became more and more radical after this period, and Truffaut, on the other hand, had become more conservative. Even if you compare 400 Blows to Breathless, Breathless was, I think, between the two, definitely the most radical film, the least tame film, as Breathless has a large amount of improvisation, not just from the actors, but also from the camera work, some of the camera work. And as they were filming, you would even find that you would learn that Jean-Luc Godard would just hurl dialogue at the actors from behind the camera and then redub the whole thing later on in the editing process. Something has to be understood about the timing of this. This was released in 1960, which was prior to the feminist movement. A lot of people, just before a lot of people started to really question these big societal constructs. And in cinema, there was also another film at the time that was seen as sort of revolutionary. If you look at a movie like Alfred Hitchcock's 1960 Psycho, released the same year, that was, in terms of editing, was revolutionary, leaving an impression of the action on the screen. And the editing in this film as well is considered to be revolutionary in that it sort of breaks the rules. The kind of jump cuts that the movie has give it a real kind of jagged, imperfect, life caught on the run type of off-the-cuff feel to the film. And then also using ideas from back in older cinema to reinvent it and create something new for the future in its use of jump cuts, which can be dated all the way back to the 1920s in silent film, the use of iris shots, which can be dated to that same period, the use of film noir narrative convention, revitalized and used for different purposes, reinvented by switching sort of the gender roles between the two. Est-ce que tu m'accompagnes, Aaron? Oui, c'est idiot, je t'aime. Je voulais te revoir pour savoir si te revoir me ferait plaisir.
Vous venez d'où, Monte Carlo?
Non, de Marseille. Je suis resté samedi et dimanche à Monte Carlo. Fallait que je voie un type. One of the things that I can appreciate about Godard is that Godard did not want to repeat the same kind of film throughout his entire career. While a lot of his French New Wave companions like Truffaut or Claude Chabrol had returned to a more controlled, more conventional kind of filmmaking, Godard just became more and more radical over time. Godard was interested in making cinema out of the small sort of arbitrary moments in life that were not shown in movies. The beginning of the movie, for instance, Michelle kills a police officer and has to get the money he needs to leave Paris to go for Rome with his love interest, Patricia. In a more conventional Hollywood film, we would actually extend the more action-like sequences. The sequence is more to do with the plot of the police trying to find Michelle and then just condense all of the everyday life scenes. What Godard does is the opposite. He condenses the scene where the police officer is murdered and then he extends all of the scenes where quote unquote nothing is happening, where characters are just walking around, hanging out and just talking to each other.
Ne bouge pas ou je te brûle.
Ah.
Jean-Luc Godard also approaches a self-conscious filmmaking that we would normally see in a future Godard acolyte like Tarantino.
Spanger rifle looks like any other rifle. Unless you know good work from bad.
This is pretty good work. Never saw any better. Yeah? This kind of rifle's worth hanging around for. I never kissed a gunsmith before.
Heavy recoil?
Including the girl from Cahiers to Cinema trying to sell Michelle a copy. This is a kind of wink and nod to the audience, knowing that Jean-Luc Godard began his career as a film critic writing for Cahiers to Cinema. This works as a kind of wave that Jean-Luc Godard can have fun with movies and the act of movie making. And part of what Breathless is about the love of movies and the love of movie making. And he also sort of brings our attention to the fact that we are watching a movie much like other films did during this era in the 60s, much like, for instance, Ingmar Bergman's Persona, which brings the attention to the camera. Godard brings our attention to the fact that we are watching a movie through a myriad of different ways. He does this through the Humphrey Bogart references when Michelle rubs his lips in a gesture that evokes Bogart, or Jean-Pierre Melville references, Jean-Pierre Melville being one of the top beloved film directors. One notable reference where the police are investigating Michelle and they ask one of the characters, and they're investigating one of the characters and they say, "Remember when you think it's your friend," which is a reference to a cat and mouse criminal crime drama that Melville had done. Or even in the alias that Michelle takes up, the alias being Laszlo Kovacs, which is a reference to a famous Hungarian-American cinematographer.
Quelle est votre plus grande ambition dans la vie?
Monsieur Arisco.
Devenir immortel. Et puis mourir.
David Serrett, a film scholar and film critic who wrote a book on Godard, called the film a mass of contradictions. And we see these contradictions in the complex high-angled framing contrasted by the casual off-the-cuff lighting, for instance, or the actors performing as actors, as performers, contradicted by them being shot against or with extras who aren't really extras, but just random people walking in Paris at the time, among real people in Paris. Godard himself had noted that when making fiction, you often document reality in that you shoot in real locations, on real locations, and when shooting documentaries, you create fiction because you control the reality through the editing. You decide what to leave and what to take out, where the story begins and where the story ends. The aesthetic of the film itself exists within a tension between reality and fiction, actuality against performance, pretense, and pretense and artificiality being a part of the same interconnected web. This film is a documentary, but a documentary about fiction, a documentary about fictional characters, where sort of fact and fiction intermingle with each other.
Qu'est-ce qu'il a dit?
Il a dit, vous êtes vraiment une dégueulasse.
Qu'est-ce que c'est, dégueulasse?
téléphone. Jean-Luc Godard, voici de nouveau avec le mépris au cœur même de toutes les conversations. Pour quelqu'un dont la discrétion est plutôt la règle, cela peut paraître curieux. Quel effet est-ce que cela vous fait, tout ce bruit autour de vous?
Ben, j'en suis pas très conscient, je crois que c'est un film. Je crois que c'est pas à cause de moi, c'est à cause du film. C'est à cause de la vedette principale, Brigitte Bardot. Je pense qu'il y a un peu plus de bruit. Enfin, tant mieux pour le film, si ça peut l'aider.
Et si d'un coup on ne parlait plus du tout de vous, quelle impression que ça vous ferait?
Oh, ça me serait complètement égal, pourvu que les gens aillent voir les films que je fais, c'est ce qui est important.
Qu'est-ce que vous pensez de la critique?
Ben, beaucoup plus de bien que n'en pensent les gens. Je crois que c'est du fait que j'ai été un ancien critique autrefois et que j'ai dit énormément de mal et j'ai été très cruel et très méchant avec beaucoup de personnes et que je n'ai pas changé d'opinion à ce propos-là. Mais enfin, quand je vois des mauvaises critiques, enfin, ce qui m'intéresse, c'est qu'on parle des choses, qu'elles soient bonnes ou mauvaises, ça m'est égal.
Mais quand une critique est mauvaise à votre propos, est-ce que vous avez un pincement?
La trouver juste ou injuste, mais pas. Non, pas du tout. Pas du tout. Ça ne me touche pas. On peut proférer les pires insultes, même personnelles. Et les critiques, justement, moi je comprends très bien ça, sont toujours personnelles en général. Je veux dire, quand ils pensent du mal de quelque chose, ils cherchent à faire du mal à la personne physique, je ne sais pas, en disant du mal de leur femme ou de leur coupe de costume ou de n'importe quoi. Je comprends ça très bien, mais ça n'a pas d'importance parce que quand on est critique, c'est un mouvement d'humeur comme ça, le lendemain c'est passé, on pense à autre chose et il ne faut pas le...
Est-ce que vous croyez qu'il peut exister une critique qui soit juste, par exemple?
Qui soit juste, oui, mais enfin la critique n'est pas une... La critique n'est pas une création artistique, ça sera toujours inférieur. Et les trois quarts des critiques, c'est un état de passage. C'est pour ça que les critiques sont toujours amères et tristes vis-à-vis de ce qu'ils louent, de ce qu'ils décrivent.
Enfin, vous, en somme, d'être devenu metteur en scène après avoir été critique, vous pensez que c'est plutôt un bel avancement?
Oui, mais je pense que c'est bien d'avoir été critique, c'est une bonne formation.
Mais est-ce que ça ne risque pas de stériliser l'imagination?
Non, parce que moi, ça m'a fait tout aimer, ça m'a appris à ne pas être sectaire, à ne pas refuser, je sais pas, Renoir au nom de Billy Wilder ou des choses comme ça. Je les aime bien tous les deux, même s'ils sont très opposés.
Est-ce que vous connaissez un critique qui a eu totalement raison à votre sujet?
Non, mais je lis pas tout.